Volcanic eruptions, asteroid impacts, and ice ages are a few of the events that probably come to mind when you're thinking of extinction events on Earth. Some big event that just happens and in an instant the Earth is set on a new course and life is never the same again. The problem with this idea of extinction events, though, is the hunk of jelly between our ears that we use to think about extinction events. We are humans and view things through a human lens on a human timeline. Even calling these times extinction events conjures images of one cataclysmic event that is singularly responsible for a mass die-off of life on the planet. This idea isn't quite right, though. What our history books and documentaries simplify into a single event happened on a geological timescale. What I mean by this is best illustrated by the definition of a mass extinction event, which is defined as losing around 75% of life on Earth over the short period of time of only 2.8 million years. The point is, mass extinctions take place on a timescale that us hairless primates are not capable of experiencing or fully understanding. But what anyone who has been paying attention does understand is that today we are losing species faster than possibly any other time in recorded history, which has some scientists asking if we are living through the beginning of Earth's next mass extinction right now. Up to this point, the Earth has seen five mass extinction events that we know of. The most famous extinction event was probably the asteroid that struck the Yucatan Peninsula and ended the last of the non-avian dinosaurs around 65 million years ago, which makes sense. People love dinosaurs ever since 1824 when William Buckland, Oxford's first geology professor, theorized that large bones that had been discovered from hundreds of years ago did not belong to giants or giant people, but were instead an extinct species of carnivorous lizard. Dinosaurs have occupied a special part of the human imagination. We had evidence that at one time, giant, terrible lizards roamed the Earth, and this wasn't some season 6 of Finding Bigfoot evidence. This was undeniable evidence of a large, powerful-looking creature that once ruled the land. Which begs the question, where did they all go? The mere understanding that something as big and powerful as dinosaurs could be wiped off the Earth, leaving behind only dusty bones, invokes a certain type of existential horror. If something came and rocked the dinosaurs' world, pun fully intended, well, who's to say some threat couldn't do the same to us?
The planet will shake us off like a bad case of fleas.
It wouldn't even be the first time the Earth pulled this nonsense. Our Earth has a messy and sordid history of breakups with life on her surface. And by messy breakups, I mean periods of time where the Earth decided to kill 75% of all life on her surface. The Earth has actually been through five mass extinction events that we know of. Earth's first it's me, not you moment of trying to break things off with life occurred nearly 443 million years ago and wiped out 85% of life on Earth in the Ordovician-Silurian extinction. That was followed by approximately 69 million, nice, years of relative stability before climate change and a loss of oxygen and carbon dioxide in the atmosphere led to the Earth's second mass extinction event, the Dinovian extinction event, around 374 million years ago. Then, after giving life on Earth 124 million years to reestablish itself, Earth decided to really shake things up. Her next breakup with life was so violent that scientists refer to this extinction event as the Great Dying, as it is believed to have wiped out 95% of all life on Earth through a combination of asteroid impacts, volcanic activity, and ocean acidification. This was the Permian extinction, but its effects weren't permanent. I'm sorry, I promise that was the last bad pun in here. Because in a short 50 million years, life on Earth had recovered enough to give Earth both the dinosaurs and the 50 million year itch to wipe out all life again. This resulted in the Triassic extinction around 200 million years ago, and was the first extinction event responsible for killing a large percentage of dinosaurs, as well as 80% of all life on Earth. Wow, that's really heavy, realizing that all life on Earth had nearly been wiped out four times in the past. It really just kind of makes you think about... Sorry, and a phone call. Hey, Mama Earth, how's it going? Yeah, I know you told me not to call you that anymore. Anyway, what's going on? I happen to have just been making a video about how quickly species are going extinct. Oh, you noticed I was a little stressed and you wanted to cheer me up with a joke? Okay, well, what's the joke then? I don't know. What do you call almost wiping out all life on Earth four times? A good warm-up! Well, we knew it was coming. Earth's fifth and most recent rage quit on life was only 65 million years ago, and is the extinction event that most of us think of when we think of an asteroid killing off the last of the dinosaurs and plunging the Earth into another ice age. And we can all agree the last thing we need is another ice age. The climate event. or the movie franchise, we're good. This was the Cretaceous extinction, and it ended up killing around 78% of life on Earth, as well as the last of the non-avian dinosaurs, which of course was bad for the dinosaurs, but fantastic for buffalo wing sales, because Earth spared the ancestors of the modern chicken and leveled the playing field enough to allow for the rise of humans that could fully tap into the chicken's tasty potential. After knowing that the necessary seeds for buffalo wings had been planted, the Earth decided to take some time off from mass extinction events for a while to work on herself. Flash forward around 65 million years, and the Earth has done a fantastic job of sticking to her no more great dyings resolution. So now that the Earth has reached its optimal form and has produced both buffalo wings and all other forms of human achievement, she's good. Right? You might be thinking to yourself that it won't happen again, or if it does, it would suck losing all those amazing plants and animals, but at the end of the day, we have amazing technology that will be able to keep our life more or less stable. And while this thought is understandable, especially if you typed it on your magic screen from the comfort of your climate-controlled house, it couldn't be further from the truth. Humans have invented incredible ways to optimize every part of life in wealthy nations, and this has created the illusion that we are separate from nature. We aren't. At the end of the day, every comfort we have and rely on comes from natural resources that are tied to climate and the health of ecosystems. Humans are an amazing species, and we will think of solutions to problems as they arise due to a worsening climate crisis propelled by the loss of critical organisms. But at some point, in the face of droughts, hurricanes, wet bulb temperatures, and the related crises caused by them, we will be harshly reminded we are part of nature and at its mercy. All of this is to say that if we are looking down the barrel of Earth's next mass extinction event, in the short term, we will adapt and make adjustments to how we do things as a society. But at some point, the world around us will be changing at such a fast rate that the infrastructure we rely on to maintain our way of life will begin to fall apart and will be available to fewer and fewer people. So now the thought might be, all right, all that sounds really bad, but that's only if we are at the beginning of another mass extinction event. If the first half of this video did anything, I hope that it illustrated the point that we don't need to worry about if the Earth will have another mass extinction event, because history has taught us to expect a mass extinction event every 50 million to 120 million years, and daily observations at this point tell us that Earth's next mass extinction event may have already begun. About 98% of all organisms that ever lived are extinct. Extinction is the natural and expected endpoint for most species on a long enough timeline, and this is compensated for by evolution leading to the rise of new species better equipped to adapt to the changing world about as quickly as species are lost. Old species dying and new species rising is how evolution marches forward, so even when all is relatively stable on Earth, there are always some animals going extinct. This is called the background extinction rate, and it was estimated to be losing one species out of every 10,000 species over 100 years. This could also be expressed as losing one species out of a million every year. If all else was stable, this is how quickly we would expect animals to go extinct. Currently, 100 species out of every million are going extinct each year. That is 100 times the background extinction rate, and is a sign that we are losing species quickly enough to consider that we are likely living through the first stages of Earth's next mass extinction. The more we learn, the worse it gets too. Recent population research has widened its scope to include insects and other bug populations. Data is much less complete for insects than vertebrates, but some estimates have pointed to a loss of 2.5% of the total biomass of insects every year. Just a quick aside, biomass is an easy way of estimating the total amount of a group of organisms by estimating their weight, which is really helpful when estimating insect populations. Anyway, losing 2.5% of insect biomass a year has two dire results. The first is, Earth's current extinction rate jumps from 100 times to 1,000 times the background extinction rate when bugs are taken into account. The second disastrous impact to this loss of invertebrate life is that insects make up one of the largest segments of the Earth's animal biomass and are one of the first trophic levels of the food web. Fewer insects and less insect biomass results in less food and energy being available for every other animal in the food chain, and that isn't even getting into all the other important roles of bugs like being pollinators or nature's cleanup crew. So that all sounds bad, but we still haven't had an asteroid impact, a volcanic eruption, or any other single cataclysmic event to launch us into a mass extinction event. The Earth could just be going through a rough patch, and maybe we will see a natural reversion to the mean and see fewer than expected extinctions over the next couple hundred years. Maybe we can avoid continuing what looks like the beginning of Earth's next mass extinction event, just as long as nothing really bad happens. Alright, well, the research is in, and it looks like we might just be the cataclysmic event that causes the next mass extinction. As I mentioned at the beginning of the video, while we often think of singular moments like volcanic eruptions as being the catalyst for global die-offs, there are usually multiple factors at play over a geologically short, but relative to us, huge timeline. To revisit the definition of a mass extinction, it is losing around 75% of all life on Earth in a little over 2.5 million years. Species loss like this is not something that progresses in a straight line. Everything in nature is connected and reliant on each other, so removing one species from an ecosystem almost always impacts many other animals and weakens the stability of their populations until eventually another species is lost, and it contributes to even less stable populations for the remaining species, and so on. When our current extinction rates are projected into the future, we are currently losing species today at a rate more than fast enough to hit mass extinction levels. Between our current extinction rates and projections for the future, researchers have already accepted that we are living through the Earth's sixth mass extinction now, and they have already given this geological time period a name. Unlike other extinction events in the Earth's history, this one wasn't caused by an asteroid impact. No, this is being referred to as the first anthropogenic extinction event. Anthrop as in humans, like in anthropology, the study of humans, and genic as in where something originated from, like Genesis. That's right, we are the disaster or the cataclysm, laying the groundwork for the next great dying. As this is the first example of a man-made extinction event, some researchers have named the time we are living in now, the Anthropocene era, because right now, nothing is having a more dominant impact on the Earth's geology and climate than human activities. Last month, earlier in 2022, a 15-year-long study was just completed, with the help of the IUCN and 961 scientists evaluating the shared conservation needs of tetrapods. The analysis found that nearly 21% of reptiles are on a path that could lead to extinction, and it gets even worse when you zoom in on specific groups. For example, 73.8% of iguanids, 60% of all snakes, and 40% of amphibians are highly threatened, and 6 out of the 7 species of sea turtle in the world are threatened. In total, this study looked at 10,196 species of reptile and found that around 2,000 reptiles, from king cobras and crocodiles to tiny geckos, are at risk of going extinct. It's not all that grim though. Some animals that are able to migrate, like birds, had a lower extinction rate of only about 13% on track for extinction, although more research is needed to know for sure. What really surprised me though is that 25% of mammals were also found to be at risk of extinction. So what can we do? And why did I make this video? When the study I just discussed was first completed, I made a YouTube short to draw attention to it, but it was a 60-second short. I had enough time to draw some attention to the study and share some highlights about the species that were going to be affected, but it was a 60-second short, so I didn't really have time to put that information into context or talk about what to do with it. The problem with that is most people know there is a problem. They might not know the specifics, like 1 in 5 reptiles and 1 in 4 mammals being at risk of extinction, but we all know mankind has an outsized impact on the planet, and if we all know there is a problem, then maybe the focus should be less on driving home the details of the problem and more on emphasizing the importance of finding a solution. That's actually a bad choice of words. In many ways, we have found solutions and we know what to do. Now it is a matter of deciding as a society and a species to implement the solutions we know will protect the habitats that animals rely on. One of the biggest things we can do to slow the rate of habitat and biodiversity loss is reducing tropical deforestation that is done for the sake of raising cattle and for palm oil production. On that note, if you are looking for a way to minimize your own impact, reducing the amount of meat you eat is one of the biggest ways to reduce your own footprint because of all the resources that are required to produce a single serving of beef. That being said, cutting down on your meat consumption or even fully cutting meat from your diet won't be enough to reverse our current trajectory. We find ourselves in an emergency that took over 100 years in all the richest nations in the world to create, and it will require the same forces of time, money, and power to undo the damage that has been done. I'm not saying that reducing your own environmental footprint is not a worthwhile undertaking, but it is also not the solution in and of itself. We need to make our voices heard at the ballots and in the streets until our leaders take this threat seriously and make big changes to stop deforestation, limit greenhouse gas emissions, and improve agriculture and supply chain productivity. We have very real, very frightening challenges ahead of us that are going to impact the animals and people that have the least to do with creating the problem the most. It is easy to feel overwhelmed or hopeless. I'm sure some doomers will watch this and will be completely unmoved because they don't care and have already given up. But we can't do that. That is what all the people who profit from the way things are now want us to do. Besides, we already know that our choices and way of life can impact the globe. We are living in the Anthropocene, after all, a period characterized by the fact that mankind's interactions with the world are the single biggest forces driving climate patterns and other ecological events. We already know humans have the power to impact the course of natural history on Earth, And who says that has to be a bad thing? Realizing that we are at the beginning of the Anthropocene extinction event is scary. It is realizing that we are standing on a very steep ledge that is crumbling away as I speak. But it also acknowledges that the power to walk away from that ledge is entirely ours as a species. We don't need to rally to stop an asteroid from hitting the Earth or plug a volcano. All we need to do is walk away from the edge. Well, there it was. I hope you enjoyed today's video. If you made it this far, thank you so much for watching all the way to the end. Hopefully it wasn't too much of a bummer, but this was a video I really felt like I had to make, especially after seeing how many people just looked incredibly hopeless in the comment section of the YouTube short that I made, talking about the new tetrapod study that found that 1 in 5 reptiles could go extinct. So I wanted to make this video to put that information in a little bit more context, and hopefully give a little bit of hope that this isn't the way things have to be. Again, thank you so much for watching all the way to the end. I know this is really different from my old content, and this won't be all of my content going forward. I'm going to get out and do some herpin. I actually have been going out and doing some herpin. I just haven't been doing a lot of finding. So as soon as I find some stuff and have some more successful trips that are worth sharing with you, I will be posting those videos. In the meantime, please let me know what you thought of this video, if you liked it, if you want to see more videos like this. Anyway, I hope you all have a fantastic rest of your week. I hope the Earth doesn't burst into flames and the animals don't pick up arms against us. But most of all, I hope that you keep herping.